Hello and welcome to the gRPC Primer presentation. My name is Neil Abogado and I'm a Senior Product Manager at Google. I appreciate you taking the time to view this video. The material that I will cover is for individuals that have some gRPC knowledge but are interested in a refresh or are new to gRPC and would like to understand the basics. It is the first in a series of videos that dive into a deeper discussion regarding many of the topics that will be mentioned. A link to the other videos in the series will be provided at the end of the presentation. Our agenda will start with some basics regarding what is gRPC, including its history, how it is used, key components, and the benefits it offers. We will discuss how gRPC is being embraced by developers to support some of the smallest to largest applications on the planet. Finally, we'll review some of the areas that Google, as one of the key contributors to the gRPC open source effort, is investing in order to enhance the gRPC user experience. Let's get started. Let's kick things off with an introduction to gRPC. First of all, it's a high-performance, open-sourced, remote procedure call framework. As you would expect as an RPC mechanism, it's built to facilitate communications between your application components, such as microservices. Google originally introduced gRPC in 2015. It is based on a successful framework that Google developed for internal purposes called Stubby. Because of our success with Stubby, Google decided it would be beneficial to create an open source option, and thus gRPC was introduced. It was accepted as a Cloud Native Computing Foundation project in 2018. One of the technologies that gRPC has a strong reliance on is protocol buffers. A protocol buffer is an open sourced, language neutral, highly efficient, extensible mechanism for serializing structured data. It acts as the interface definition language, or IDL, for gRPC. In this case, protocol buffers are used to define the data structures which are leveraged to communicate via gRPC calls. Another technology that is often deployed with gRPC is a service mesh. While using a service mesh is not mandatory, organizations often combine service mesh capabilities such as load balancing, encryption, and service discovery to improve the security, availability, and scalability of their applications. Proxyless service mesh is gaining in popularity since it offers a lower overhead with higher performance option when compared to a traditional sidecar design. Now, I won't go into too much detail on this topic, but you should review the dedicated video regarding proxyless gRPC and service mesh for more information. The final comment is that as a flexible RPC framework, it should not be a surprise to find that a variety of developer types, including backend, web, and mobile developers, are the primary users of gRPC. Here are some of the benefits of gRPC. First off, it offers high performance. gRPC is designed for low latency and high throughput communications. Next, gRPC is designed to be scalable. This means that you can use gRPC to communicate with a large number of services without impacting performance. gRPC supports duplex streaming, which allows for more efficient communications as data can be forwarded as a stream is being generated. Security is front and center since gRPC supports a variety of security features to protect your applications, such as TLS encryption and authentication. gRPC implementations can interoperate even if they're written in different programming languages and running on different platforms. Finally, gRPC is extensible, as you can add new features and functionality by writing plugins. Now that we've touched on the components and benefits of gRPC, let's walk through a simple microservices example that fits all the pieces together and demonstrates how protocol buffers and gRPC are used as a part of a developer workflow. Step one starts by using protocol buffers to define in a source file the structure for the data that you want to serialize. This is an ordinary text file with a .proto extension. Once you specify the messages and services, you use the programming language specific protocol buffer compiler to generate gRPC client and server code, including the code for populating, serializing, and retrieving your RPC messages. Next, as we highlight in steps 2 and 3, we have the gRPC and application source codes compiled together to deliver a binary. The binary object can then be combined with application-specific configuration information to create a package. The package can then be deployed to, for example, instantiate a microservice. Since its introduction, gRPC has made progress in multiple areas. First off, we've seen a steady increase in the number of organizations that are leveraging gRPC in their application stack. To learn more about how companies like Spotify, Salesforce, Juniper Networks, Cockroach Labs, Square, and Netflix use gRPC to improve their businesses, please visit the CNCF gRPC website. We have also seen a growing number of developers embrace gRPC and increased gRPC support in the developer community. We'll walk through some data points that offer more insights on this subject momentarily. Finally, as gRPC matured with over 100 releases since inception, it has increased its features, including support for over 10 popular programming languages. A key example to illustrate how gRPC is being received by the developer community is the feedback shared on its main repository, GitHub. The GitHub star count is a metric often used to measure how popular an open source project is. As you can tell from the chart, we've had a sizable and steadily increasing star count since the framework was introduced. Beyond GitHub, many of you are probably familiar with NPM, the default package manager for Node.js. gRPC packages are averaging 6 million weekly downloads from NPM. When we take a look at the Python package index, we find that the gRPC.io package receives an average of 2 million downloads a day and is one of the most downloaded packages. Finally, we have Apache Maven. Again, gRPC is quite active with over 12 million downloads per month from this site. Microservices with gRPC is a very popular use case and an important area of focus for the gRPC team. That said, we were honored when gRPC recently received the Best in Microservices Infrastructure Award at the API World. A common question that we receive is, what are some of the items that are actively being pursued to improve gRPC? The following are three areas of focus for the Google gRPC maintainers. Observability improves the ability for developers to understand how their RPCs are functioning, improves notifications, and helps troubleshoot issues when they arise. Proxyless Service Mesh enhances the capabilities that gRPC makes available when deployed in a service mesh environment. While documentation is delivering a suite of assets that can educate and help coders move through the different phases of the development process. Let's go into more detail regarding each one of these topics. gRPC Observability provides tools to collect and present telemetry data, including metrics, logs, and traces in the Google Cloud Operations Suite from workloads deployed on the Google Cloud platform. These capabilities assist developers in establishing a holistic understanding of how RPC calls are performing, making it easier to troubleshoot issues and optimize workloads. While gRPC Observability recently became available, we are planning to build off this base to incorporate new metrics, enhanced dashboards, and increase programming language support. Stay tuned. Also, for more information regarding gRPC Observability, please watch the dedicated video that will walk you through the details of this topic. We mentioned Proxyless Service Mesh and some of its benefits earlier. That said, the gRPC maintainers have plans to make enhancements to improve the services offered. The custom load balancing capability is a recent example of one of these features. It allows the use of new metrics such as the CPU utilization of a backend microservice or arbitrary user data to make load balancing forwarding decisions. A final comment is, similar to observability, Google has a Proxyless Service Mesh video available that will share additional details regarding how and why you should use PSM in your applications. As we start to wrap up, I'd like to invite you to continue your gRPC journey by taking advantage of the various resources that are available, including viewing the other videos that are part of this series, visiting the gRPC.io site for helpful tips on getting started with gRPC, requesting a conversation with the maintainers to help answer any questions you might have, and finally, joining the gRPC mailing list to stay current on all things related to gRPC.